Painting with Menoth John is presented in Super Legitivision. Super Legitivision, the future of podcasting. It's .com.
Hello, I'm
Menoth John.
And I'd like to welcome you. First of all, let me take just a moment to thank you for allowing me back into your homes. If this is your first time with us, let me extend a personal invitation for you to drag out your
miniatures
and paint along with us each week. Let's go over to the canvas here and let's get started.
I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. Let's build a happy little cloud. Let's build some happy little trees. There are no limits here. You start out by believing here. You can almost paint with anything.
Let's get ready to rumble! Yes, ladies and gentlemen, it is Sunday night, and that means that it is all right, and this is the Sunday Night Extravaganza, and I am your host, who apparently doesn't understand how to not blow the ears off of people listening to the podcast. I am Menoth John. I am here, your host, for 90 minutes of shenanigans and good times that we are going to provide you a distraction that you can paint to, or yuck it up in the chat room if you are so inclined. I'm sitting in the ghost chair. It's pretty cool. Chroma key. It's a thing. So I am, of course, Menoth John. I mentioned that. Up there in the catbird seat, you know him as the co-host with the mo-host. He is the wind beneath my wings. He is the mighty right hand of the podcast. He is Mr. John Spencer.
Heyo.
Heyo. And, of course, sitting right next to him, weighing in at 192 pounds from parts unknown, the scruffy, the irrational Gonzo! Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we are up. You know, they must have spiked my geritol because I'm in kind of an exciting mood. I'll tell you what, folks. I'll tell you right now, there are ways to play this game that involve dice. And we have a new way for you to play this game tonight that was released in the No Quarter. It's called Extreme Colossal Wrestling because extreme. And it's super fun and totally legit. And I am here to give you a review of my first game with my son, Troll Chuck. It was super fun, but we're going to get to that later. We start the show off with booze because, as you can tell, we probably haven't had enough already. I haven't had any yet either, which is kind of amazing. You know, guys, we celebrate holidays in the United States. Were you aware of that?
Yes.
Okay, we celebrate holidays, and one of them was a holiday just was called St. Patrick's Day, which celebrates the Catholic patron saint of snake removal, and so. This guy, he rolled up on Ireland and said, "Get the fuck out of here, snakes." And then they did, and now we get drunk because of it. So I'm having some Jameson Irish whiskey. That's pretty much how it goes, right? That's the right story, right, guys?
Oh, you mean amateur night.
Exactly. So
I'm just wondering why you had to have a holiday to drink.
I know, right?
I'm alive. Let's drink.
Exactly. Woohoo! So I'm drinking Jameson. That's Irish whiskey. It's not... And then you... Irrational, I believe, are having another UK or former UK favorite.
Scotland,
yeah.
Macallan 18.
Ireland's part of the UK, right? Probably not. Anyway, so Macallan 18, that sounds great. What happened to the other 17?
There's only a 12.
Was it 12?
Then it jumps to 18, because that's how they count.
That's Irish, man.
17, 18. And they're done, and that's it.
You know, that's the story now, and we're sticking to it. So there you go. Mr. Spencer, what are you having tonight?
I've got a shot of Loconut, coconut rum.
Loconut. There you go. All right, well, folks, you know, however you choose to celebrate the banishment of snakes, here you go. Hey, Ron.
Ron.
Shoram Begora. All right. So there you go. That's Irish, right? So there you go. Okay. All right. So we're going to talk, but we've got a lot of things to talk about. We're going to talk about the best things here on Painting with Menoth John. We're going to use the best words, the biggest words, and we're going to have a bigly show for you for sure. If I get to painting, it could happen. I've got some Feora3 action here. My Little Pony. I'm going to be working on her. And we're going to be basing that, of course, on the color scheme of the Brown Eye of Truth, which we all know and love. And we'll talk about that when we get to the painting cam. We're also going to be talking about, and you could probably figure it out from the, you know, now Sean threw me off in the chat room. Aaron, go bra. Well, what if Aaron wants to go braless? There's nothing wrong with that. So we celebrate diversity here on this show. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the Extreme Colossal Wrestling. We have visual aids, and we hope there'll be a cure for those someday. And we're going to go ahead and...
Jesus Christ.
And we're going to...
I like that.
That was a good one.
Wow.
So we're off to a roaring start. Folks, you know, we want you to support the show, and the best way to support the show is to get over here to patreon.com/menothjohn. We don't talk about it often enough, but we have some new patrons, and we're going to write that shit down, and we're going to celebrate all of the patrons not next week, because that's Adepticon, but the week after. And John, what's special about that show?
We're going to do an all-day show. That's right. We're going to go crazy and do this all day.
An all-day show, you say?
Yep.
That's crazy talk. You know, we haven't done one of those in a couple of years, John, and I think what we're going to try and do is something similar to what we did on that one, is we want to donate to some charity. We're going to, in between now and then, I'm going to set up a GoFundMe, much along the same lines we did for JohnCon, and people, if you want to donate, we're going to pick a very worthy type of charity that we're going to put in there, and every dollar that goes into the GoFundMe is going to go to a charity that we're going to choose, and we'll figure something out. We don't know exactly which one yet, but it'll be a good one. We already got the food shelf of Racine, Wisconsin already covered. We'll figure out something that's maybe a little bit more nationally oriented for this one. So that's coming up, not this coming Sunday, but the Sunday afterwards, and that'll be super sweet and totally legit. Painting some stuff. I'm going to be working on the Siege Crawler. I'm hoping to paint the entire Siege Crawler during that. And we're all going to be here doing crazy shit, so it'll be super fun and totally legit. Also, remember, folks, if you get over to the patreon.com/menothjohn and support all this fantasticness, and you are a member in good standing at the $1 level or higher, you will be entered into, and you submit a picture to pwmenothjohn@gmail.com, and you put Brushhead Gallery in this. God, there's so many, like, contingencies in this. You're going to get entered in for a really super amazing contest. We're going to be giving away, I think we're going to do the Hunter's Guild. Not the Hunter's Guild. We're going to do the Butchers. We're going to do the Butchers right off the get-go, and we're going to put it in one of those X cases, and that was painted by Side Hustle Seth. And you've seen his work. That stuff is legit. That guy can paint the shit out of anything. Side Hustle Studios, if you want your stuff painted, he'll paint the shit out of it for you. So we're going to be doing that we're going to be doing that during the normal time. The Brushhead Gallery is going to be that during that long all-day show, but we're going to block it out at the 7 o'clock p.m. time when we start the show. We're going to block that out. That will be the Brushhead Gallery. And we'll see how schnockered I am by that time, folks. That ought to
just
be.
Just make sure you find stuff that's low proof. Low proof. You can do it all day.
It's not alcohol, then. That's Kool-Aid.
I'll be careful.
The kids' juice here. The coconut rum. It's kids' juice.
You know, I was looking to. I got to go check another liquor store because I wanted to find some more of that that cannon blasty stuff with, or the coca shit or whatever it is. I want some of that nonsense. Yeah, there you go. That stuff's really kind of pretty good.
It's very good to drink by itself, which is, I find, rare in certain types of alcohol.
Yep. So we're going to do that, and it's going to be really fun, and we're going to do a lot of crazy stuff, and we'll have guests who might just dial in. We'll see. I don't know. I hope people will dial in. It'll be fun. And we'll have a good old time. So, let's see. Is there anything else, John, that we needed to cover before we got going here?
Next week, there is likely to not be a show. I am trying to see if I can work something out, but I think with us doing the all-day show the next weekend, I'm going to try and get stuff done in advance so that we have more stuff ready for that.
Yeah, I'm literally not even going to be able to... I'm going to be taking Rich back to the airport at that time. So it's not even something... I mean, I love you guys, but I'm not going to Skype and drive because that's just illegal and just dead. So not...
Haven't you seen Doctor Strange? We know how this ends.
Exactly. I had the opportunity to watch that on the airplane this time, but I chose to watch... I watched Arrival again, which was amazing. And I got to see Shin Godzilla, the latest one from Japan. Holy fuck! We'll talk about that during the movie section. Oh my god, it's the best Godzilla ever! Anyway.
That sounds like we're going to have a big movie section. I got a couple to talk about, too.
Well, we'll cut the nonsense early. We'll go for a full half hour on the movie section maybe tonight.
Shit.
So, all right, guys. We are... I want to get over to... Whoop, there goes my... So I got to fix the timeout on my monitor because I got to shake the mouse too often. That sounds like a euphemism.
Shake it like a Polaroid.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and we are going to swoop in on the painting cam. Here it comes, folks. Swooping in like a majestic elk or something. I don't know if I'm going to be able to make this work. Oh, so this is
elk swoop.
Well, elks swoop better than things that don't at all. So...
Fucking Christ. Yeah. Like, absolutely true, sir. I cannot argue with that logic.
That's right. Okay, so folks, here we go. I'm going to go ahead and bring in extra light because as the president for life of War Machine and Hordes, I can say, let there be light. And
so
there is.
Your picture, of course, is mirrored, so that's all backwards.
I know, but this is a challenge for the Brushheads. So if you can follow along with this, it has visual aids. We should all feel sorry for it. And one of the ways that it manifests itself is by being mirrored. So I don't know how to fix it. Maybe I'll fix it someday. But
if
anyway.
You've got the latest No Quarter, which looks like this.
Yeah, follow along.
And if your store doesn't have it, it might be hiding behind the Signar command books they stacked up in front of them. Store.
So this is a great No Quarter, by the way. I mean, literally one of the best ones I think I've ever seen. Between the lore associated with Gorshade of Retribution, and you got the theme list for the Gators in there, plus you've got a whole new game, and it's called Extreme Colossal Wrestling. So now, John, have you had a chance to look at anything related to this?
I bought the issue. I read the rules. I did a once over of them. Okay. Seems okay.
Yeah. So let's talk about it a little bit. I'm trying to adjust my light here so that it's a little bit more relevant. There we go. That nothing says professional like bumping the camera with the light. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about this. So this is at least a little bit inspired by Colossal Mania, which was we had in the Hardcore Casual pack number one that we put out a while ago, and that was thanks to... And I'm going to forget his name, and I hate myself. Do you remember the gentleman's name that gave it to us?
See, now you put me on the spot.
No, it's look up the Bleeped Up podcast. If you bring up the Bleeped Up podcast, you'll find him. Or Murder of Crows. Either one of those.
Yeah, I feel really horrific, though, because we should remember his guy.
No,
Lee McAlpin.
We've had him on the show.
Lee McAlpin.
Yeah, Lee McAlpin. So... If this wasn't directly inspired by Colossal Mania by Lee McAlpin, then it's certainly like Calculus, where it was developed sort of in a vacuum and at the same time. But it's really, really similar. Essentially, what you've got is it's a two-person game, or it can be a four-person game for a little tag team action. And you play it on a 30x30 board because that's kind of the new fun thing that they're doing with a lot of their alternative formats, is that they're putting them on 30x30s. So it is literally colossal on colossal wrestling with different moves. Now, so what we've got here is you've got a bunch of different moves that are super easy to read because the camera's mirrored, and you have action points. So it's an action point game, guys. You have five to start the game, and you get three every round, okay? And then there's a bidding mechanic where each person decides out of their pool of action points how many are they going to use, and they you put the beads underneath the table, and then you reveal simultaneously. So I go, I'm going to do 3 action points. The other person might have 4. The person with the least number of action points is the one then that gets to go first. Okay? So then you spend your action points, your opponent spends their action points, and it's the end of the round. Everybody gets 3 more new pieces of glass, new beads to put in their action point pool, and then you wash, rinse, repeat over and over again. And but what really makes it fun is that the sides of the table are in the lore, electrified steel. So they hurt the colossal by getting thrown into them. And it's all about... Was it Signar? No, Signar doesn't even get away with this one. It's broken swans. All right, so... Fuck those swans. All right, so here are your stats. You've got speed, strength, tech, which is technique, showmanship, and then end, which is endurance. Okay, so endurance is like your health. And as you... And these are not like points you scratch off. These are how many dice you get to throw in your pool. The rules are 100% not War Machine and Hordes. Yeah,
100%.
Yep. Sassy, you're absolutely right. This is a cage match, and it's super sweet. So this is, let's see here. Your friend at Dice said, okay, sweet. All right, so we got, it's all backwards. I don't read French, John. That's great. So... The strength, so this is your dice pool. So if we're doing a move that requires strength, I would roll 4 dice. Now let me give you an idea of kind of how different this is. When my son Chuck, who's 10 years old, and I played this, had a hell of a time. He was playing King of Giants, which is a mountain king. And its endurance is 12. Now remember, the Judicator was 9. His strength is 6. And so he gets to roll 6 dice versus my 4. But if you'll notice, my technique is a lot better. So there are different... My technique on the Judicator is a 4. His is a 2. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to focus on moves that are technique-based. Okay? And so you got all these moves, and it becomes really kind of strategic as to which one you're going to take. And so then here's another one. Here is the Galleon, otherwise known as Bilgerat Brawler. Okay? And you can take or leave these names. It's up to you. Whatever you want to do. But they all have different special names, special things. Like here's the Dropkick the Ref. For 1 action point, that's a special one here. This maneuver can only be performed once per game. Immediately move any number of action points from your pool to your bid action points. So let's say you have 5, 6, or 7 action points, and you bid 1, okay, so you could go first. You spend that 1, and your whole pool comes sliding into your bid now after you won initiative. So it's really kind of fun and really kind of deep. So to give you an indication of kind of how the gameplay is, when Chuck and I were playing, he was playing the Mountain King. We talked about that, the King of Giants. And I was playing the Lawbringer because, you know, reasons. And I went ahead and I had whittled him down a little bit. So I walked over to him. And I did a suplex. Not a suplex, a suplex. Nice pun, by the way. And I used my technique versus his technique. So I was already at 4. I got a +1 on that one. So I'm up to 5 dice. And he's got 4, and he's got 2 dice. And as it turns out, 5s and 6s are successes in this, okay? And 6s explode. And when you do a move like this, like an attack... What you do is you look at your successes versus their successes, and that determines the amount of damage that you do, essentially. It's like it's called a smackdown value, okay? And in this case, the attack is successful. The defender loses the endurance equal to the attacker's smackdown value, okay? So now you're saying to yourself, well, what if you don't successfully pull off that move? Well, your opponent gets to counterattack. And not only can they use the number of action points they've got in their pool, in their bid, but they can also use how many they've got in their pool. They get 1 move, and they get to do it back to you. So it's really, really cool. So you've got that. You've got a lot of interplay between the different things. When our game ended, I had done a suplex, And then I had one action point left, so I used a whip. Here it is. And he said, and I said, see me whip, see me nay-nay, see me whip, 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 see me nay-nay. So I whipped him, and
I didn't think this could be more painful.
Oh. So, and on this one, what you do is you use your strength or your tech versus the defenders, and then you get to, that determines how many dice you get to have in your throw pool, and you throw the opposing colossal as many inches as that roll was. And I beat him by 3 successes, so I threw him 17 inches. And you bounce off the ropes in this game. So I threw him 7 inches into the ropes. He took 2 damage from the ropes, and they came back. And then he was down to 1 endurance, and I was able to pin him. And the way you pin him in this game is you have to do pin attempt. You spend 2 action points, and your defender is rolling with their endurance. So I had him down to 1 endurance, which means he only got 1 die. And I had, I was using my tech, which was 4. So it was 4 dice against 1, and you have to win 3 times in a row. And every time you win, you have to go, 1! And then if you do it again, 2! And you're supposed to smack your hand down on the table, which of course we did. And 3, and then it was the pin. And if you don't get, if you miss it, one of those attempts, the opponent kicks out. And your turn ends. So isn't that sweet?
It's very wrestling. It is very wrestling.
It's super wrestling. It's amazing. The board is 30 by 30. And so the edges of the board come into play a lot, which is really, really fun. And as you start figuring out kind of the strategies of it, you got to use those ropes to your advantage, because you can do a big, you can do like a strike or a body slam or something like that. And maybe you can throw them right into the ropes. So you not only do you get the big bonus for that, you get for the damage, but you also get the rope damage. It's really cool. Mm-hmm. Here's some other ones. This is I showed the Bilgewater Brawler. Here's Old Danger Snake. That's the Crix one. Danger Snake. That used to be my...
I think when they named these, someone was watching wrestling, but had just previously watched Pacific Rim.
Oh, snap. Or Atlantic Rim.
No,
they didn't have names. They weren't good enough to have names on Atlantic Rim. Well, more on that later, folks. But each of the different robots have different special throws that they can do. I want to point out one of these on the King of Giants. There is the beat on chest, which for 2 action points, you get to then your dice on your next non-pin attempt explode on 5s and 6s. So now you got the chance to really rack up. So if you just put the beat on the chest and then come in with the big meaty chop, you're talking about some pretty serious damage you could be inflicting on that other guy, because he's starting at 6, and you're going to see some 5s and 6s, and those I had dice explode a couple of times on that one. That was really good. So John Gonzo, your thoughts on what I've been talking about so far?
Go ahead, Gonzo. You seem speechless.
No, I actually, it sounds like a ton of fun. And I just from looking at this, it sounds like it's just stupid fun.
Oh yeah.
Just because it makes stupid noises, makes stupid things, do stupid stuff. You know, I mean, I could see people doing this like a convention and having like a fake War Machine Weekend, you know, wrestling belt at the end, and make, you know, people, you know, just make it loud and stupid. Because that's what it seems like. It's just have a good time with it is what it seems like to me. And it sounds like it, because I'm a very animated player. So as soon as I saw that the big giant beats on his chest, you know damn well, if I do that, I'm going to beat on my chest and then make stupid wrestling noises and throw around.
It's going to be amazing. Gonzo, are you bringing any... you're bringing your Kadoran one, right?
Colossal. Yeah, I'm bringing a Conquest.
Okay. So, I mean, he's in here. John, your thoughts?
It does seem interesting. I like that they're doing more fun stuff rather than serious stuff. And, something might get a little bit of play once in a while. at the LGS when you'll have enough time for a full game.
Yep.
Definitely willing to give it a shot.
Plague Reaper, most definitely there will be Colossal Wrestling at Adepticon in the Iron Arena. On Saturday, for sure, when I've got Charlie with me. He may be with me on Friday also. Haven't quite figured all that, the logistics out just yet. But it's entirely possible he might be with me on Friday also, in which case we will be doing some Colossal Wrestling whenever he's around. He knows the game. He loves it. He had so much fun. He got in. He was really getting into it, and we were having a great time doing ring announcer stuff, and it is just a ball of fun. So please make sure that you come on down for your Adepticon. Seek me out, and I will for sure have some of my Colossals with me so that I can play this. I've got 5 of the 11, so I will probably bring all 5 of mine at some point or time during it. So, cool. All right, so I think we've probably talked enough about Colossal Wrestling for now. What do you think, John?
No, I think we definitely covered it. Hopefully everyone's excited for it, picks up the issue, takes a look at the rules.
Yep, for sure. I think this is really, really going to be a lot of fun for a lot of people. I am going to... go ahead.
I'm going to wear a feather boa, have a big old headdress and walking in, jumping, holding my Colossal above my head, having a big old hype man behind me. You got it. I can just see this. There's going to be so much trouble. I'm getting so much trouble.
Oh, it's going to be so much fun. It is going to be so much fun. I got to fix let's see. Is this better if I hold it like this? Let's see here. I got to fix the focus on the old painting cam here because for some reason it's not happy. So I'm going to start doing some painting here, guys. And let's see. What else were we going to talk about on the show, John?
Well, you ask people for questions. I feel like we should answer those.
Let's go answer some questions. I mean, I've been talking for half hour here. Let's go ahead and answer some questions.
All right. We got, looks like a half dozen questions so far, and I'm sure, you know, everyone in the chat room always chimes in. So let's start with some non-serious here from Kevin Brook. He says, what goes good with ravioli?
Oh, God. That's, Gonzo, take that one first.
Ritz crackers. Ritz crackers go good with ravioli, especially if it's Chef Boyardee in a can. God damn.
Oh.
Oh. I'm not okay with how where this is going. This is a family program, Gonzo.
So I actually do see if you have good ravioli that Ritz crackers could go well with them. That actually sounds good to me. In good conscience, allow anyone to eat Chef Boyardee ravioli out of a can.
That's really bad.
Last
I mean, that's
the time I did it.
That's
yeah,
like
it
Nathan.
No bueno.
That's like Nathan Hoffman style hobo. Nobody wants to be that kind of hobo. I mean, yeah, Nathan Hoffman, cool. Nathan Hoffman hobo, not okay.
I mean, the only time I get ravioli is from Local Lido's Pizza, and it smells like spicy ravioli. And what goes well with that? A good Corona or something to wash it down.
Yeah, you know, with a ravioli, I guess I would hope that there would be some garlic bread in play.
Oh, okay.
Because I mean, garlic bread is a natural ally of ravioli. I would think that I would want some garlic bread, and I want it to be nice and crusty. So it can't be soggy, and so it needs to be well baked.
Soggy garlic bread is the worst.
Yeah, so. There you go. I think that's probably where I would go.
Comic Scotty says, I did it for lunch at work this week. It left a film in my mouth.
Left a film on your soul is what it did.
Oh. And who is this? Nansage11 says, Jaeger. Jaeger goes with anything. As long as it's ice cold, I'll give it a shot, but that's probably not true. Actually, I know that's not true. Because Jaeger does not go with Cherry Smash. Trust me. Jaeger and Cherry Coke? Quite good. Jaeger and Cherry Smash? No.
What the actual fuck is Cherry Smash?
It's a cherry drink. It's not like Cherry Cola. It's like cherry-flavored drink.
Yishkabibble.
Kazunotite?
That sounds not awesome. Just going to put that out there.
It's okay, but with Jaeger, just drink your Cherry NyQuil instead. It's probably better.
Because frankly, you've already muscled up to the Jaeger. NyQuil is probably your friend already. You're probably drinking that recreationally at this point anyway. Try Sterno. Sterno might be right up your fucking alley.
Wow. Oh. So from crazy and horrible to Will Hahn, do you plan to bring back the joy of playing?
You know, oh, that is such an interesting thing to bring up, because I was horsing around with the XSplit today, kind of getting ready for the show, and I came across the fact that we have the joy of playing template. So I'm just going to, just for old time's sake, I'm going to bring up the template here. And there it is. So there you go. If you're feeling nostalgic for the joy of playing, that was some pretty high fucking quality graphics I had come up with for that show. but, you know, I think now that Jeff is done getting married in his pajamas on the couch with his cats, I'm sure that, and I haven't talked to DC in a little while, but I think we should. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to reach out to those guys, and maybe we can do an impromptu joy of playing in the middle of the all-day affair. What do you think about that, John?
That sounds cool, because that gives me and Gonzo a chance to go get food.
Yeah, and then I can leave after that, and you guys can
Yeah. I'm not allowed to leave.
Yeah. It's Penny with Mouth John. We can't have it without Mouth John.
You guys are sadly mistaken. because if I don't eat all damn day, bad times, shirts will come off.
Sweet.
That's good. We want the ratings.
Yeah,
that's
exactly
how we get the ratings.
Yes, it is how we drive ratings on this show. It's 100 viewers to get me to take the shirt off, 120 to get it back on. So
125 nipple piercing?
No. Nope. I'm not drunk enough I'm not drunk enough to say yes to that. So you're probably asking yourself, self, where is Menoth John going with this color scheme? So I'm pretty fond of what I did with the brown eye of truth, and I'll show it to you here in just a second. I will be showing you the brown eye here in a second. And
wow, save that for the all day
family
cat,
program.
Man.
So here's the brown eye. And so the broad plates are going to be this coal black that I'm pretty fond of. And then we're going to come out with a lot of Rulik gold. So, and I think that's going to look best if I do that.
Yeah.
Did you see that one? I think it was on the painting Facebook page where the guy took the head and put an eyeball actually in it.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Instead of putting the head in there, there was an actual like eyeball looking at people. And I was like, that's creepy cool.
That is creepy cool. I thought you were going to talk about the guy that from my local meta that is using very similar color scheme to what I chose to do, and that's cool. I mean, it's nice that people like the color scheme that I picked enough to want to copy it.
May not remember it, but a couple years back, Jan got into Rulik for his mercenaries. He's like, "Okay, this awesome paint scheme I got came up with," and it was exactly the same paint scheme. Well. Functionally exact same paint scheme I painted my Rulik models in.
Yeah.
And I called him. He's like, fuck, that's why it looked so good. Someone already done it.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
And I am sure that I am not the first person to do the scheme that I'm doing. So, I mean, I'm not claiming ownership of the color coal black. I'm just going to put that out there.
Coal black. If you want to use coal black, you give John a nickel.
You call me, bitches. No, that's not where we're at on this show. I mean... I would like to be original someday, but I don't see it happening. I'm just going to put it out there.
I will say that Not Brushhead Dave has his own type of red that... I'm not going to say the name because he has not given me the okay to use his full name there, but let's say it's Not Brushhead Dave Red. And if we use that particular red, you usually ask him for advice.
There you go. It's because he actually mixes his own blood into it, and that's what makes it special.
Wow, that's hardcore. I don't think he's that hardcore.
Well, he might.
You've met Not Brushhead Dave. I don't think he gives enough fucks to mix his blood with that
paint.
I'm
pretty sure he doesn't, but that's okay. It sounded good coming out of my mouth, though.
Not Brushhead Dave is probably the king of giving no fucks.
Yeah.
I love him.
You want to know how many fucks he gives? Not even zero. There you go.
Yeah, not even.
Not even zero. He gives less zero.
So Clockwork Jester in chat room wants to know, any suggestions for helping build up community? He plays with a handful of people every week, but we'd like more people to play with.
Gonzo?
I would definitely post up, if you have a bulletin board, post up stuff. Talk to your friends' friends. Go to conventions. Even if it's not a War Machine-specific convention, go to a convention where people play Infinity or play any other type of game or 40K and talk to people. Don't ever, ever, ever put down someone else's game.
No.
You may not like it, but that's like the worst thing you can do is put down someone else's game. Talk to them about it and be interested in them. Find out what they like. Oh, okay. And then you can build around that. Demo days. Bring all your crap into a demo day. Do a demo day all day. Paint. Do a painting day. You just got to get involved. It's got to, if you got a local college, even better. Post that. Post up flyers around the local college. Get the permission first.
Yeah.
But yeah, you gotta work your butt off. It's not just, oh, I'm going to sit here and wait till people come in. No, you talk to your friends, you talk to their friends, and then you talk to their friends. And you find out who's in it. Facebook, post it on Facebook. Hey guys, I'm going to be doing a demo on Saturday from here to here and have everybody share it out.
Yep. And if you don't have a Facebook group for your local group, get one. Because it's really a great way. If nothing else, it's a great way to post messages and make sure you've got a game when you show up to the game store.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know that... Go ahead.
Something you could do, I mean, you don't have to spend your own money, but sometimes I would say, and I would have free paintbrushes. Something small, you don't have to give away a ton of stuff, but say if you come here and do a demo, you're entered in a prize for, you know, a set of paintbrushes or a set of basic paints or, you know, whatever you can afford, if you can afford that.
Talk to the store. They might help you out with it, might give it to you a cost or something, or might even cover it entirely because it is going to help get people into their store and people come in, usually buy stuff.
You know, one might think that since the Press Gang program has gone away and they've decided to support stores more, that might be a creative way for the stores to help kind of use some of that additional support, and maybe they give away some of those P3 brushes that they have.
Mm-hmm.
So something to suggest. Those are excellent suggestions, guys.
Yeah, and also in addition, I would say if you're at the local store, make sure the local store knows about all your events, can tell people about the events, make sure the whole staff knows, make sure the magic guy knows, the Pokemon lady, everyone. And if you're playing and you got time, get a table on the alternate game days just so they can see you're playing it. And when you're going to demo, you know, going to play with those on those days, try and bring fully painted. It gets more people to the table, gets them asking more questions, and you might find someone who's willing to jump in.
Yeah, you know, and the other thing is, you know, if you're going to have a day that your store is going to say this is War Machine Day, make sure you're getting there as often as you can, because mm-hmm. you want to show the prospective players that it's a consistent and vibrant community, so that they want to show up, and maybe they've got a bad week and they can't show up, but at least somebody's there to play a game with them when they get there, because nothing's more discouraging than going to a game store, sitting by yourself, and then leaving.
Yep, I've been there every Wednesday since we've started a push for community. And, I mean, it's not easy, but I do it.
Yeah, no, that's serious, important stuff.
Especially now.
Yeah, especially now.
All right, let's get a couple more easy ones. And Crimson 1919 has a pretty hardcore one that I may even steal and save for the all-day cast.
Sounds
in fact,
good.
I'm going to do that, Crimson. I'm going to save this one for the all-day cast because it's going to require a little bit of in-depthness. And I don't want to not do it justice because we're running on a time limit tonight. We'll talk about it when we got all the time in the world.
What's the question?
It's about competitiveness in War Machine.
Excellent.
We actually had a pretty deep conversation about that.
Hey. It's definitely one you can have a deep conversation about, but I don't want to, like I said, do it a little bit. So, Side Hustle Seth says, when is it appropriate to steal / borrow someone else's army scheme?
Anytime you like it.
Yeah, always.
And then, you know, but make sure that when you talk to somebody, if you do use their scheme, make sure you give the person credit as being, hey, I love the scheme too. This is a scheme that I borrowed from such and such, if you can figure out who it was from. And mm-hmm. just make sure that you give them credit. And then I would hope that if that person borrowed that scheme from somebody else, that they would also give credit as well. Just, you know, just let people know that like I was saying before, you know, having someone copy your scheme is a great compliment. They want, mm-hmm. they like your scheme so much that they're willing to put it on something that they spend hundreds of dollars on. And so that's a wonderful, beautiful thing. Just make sure you give people credit. Guys?
I agree. 100%. Shouldn't be any problem. I mean, just say, like, hey, this is what John did on his, and I really liked it, so I'm painting mine like that.
Yep, that's super cool.
And if they get upset with you, fuck them.
And that was what's, you know, Scott, the guy that did that used a similar scheme for his Brown Eye of Truth was, he said, you know, he was inspired by what I had done with mine, and I was very humbled by that, very humbled.
Mm-hmm. Most people won't care.
Yeah, very few people care. If they care, then they may be taking things a little too seriously.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, this I didn't copyright the color coal black, that's for sure.
What?
I don't get to do that. Probably a mistake on my part.
All right, well, back to silly.
Okay, we're good at silly.
Chris Everly asks, if one has a good poop and there is no one to tell, was it a good poop?
Well, that's what blogs are for.
That's, I was going to say Facebook.
That's Facebook. Yep.
Twitter.
Snapchat.
Media, social media. Snapchat, take a picture of the good poop.
So, folks, if you have a particularly solid good poop this week, not by solid, but, you know, I'm not talking about, I'm not going to judge. If your poop is a little loose, that's okay. Sometimes that happens depending upon whether or not Mexican food was in the play. I suggest that you tweet us at MenothJohn, hashtag good poop. We'll read the hashtag good poops on the all day show for sure. We're gonna search for that hashtag and we're gonna read them. So
now I have a wireless headset.
Not so much. That's an on location. We're not gonna bite on. So there you go. So. By the way, folks, if I can get an internet connection while at Adepticon, there will be some impromptu live streamings. So I'll go ahead and just kind of go live on Facebook, because those kids today with their rock and roll music, they can go ahead and get their live stream on all over the place. But I'm not going to like have a 14 billion gigabits worth of data usage.
1.21 gigawatts.
Yeah, that one too.
All right, well, back to serious. Robert Dreski, our own flight medic, says,
that guy.
How do you balance painting, family, work, and the need for sleep?
Family first, family first, work second, sleep third, everything else after.
Gonzo?
Give up sleep. Just give it up. Don't worry about it.
It's all good till the psychotic break takes place, though.
That's the reason why you like nap while you're driving or when you're working.
I've heard working is best.
No, MF John does not support napping while driving.
Not officially. That was in quotation marks. So we know that that could be literally anything now. We've learned that. Thank you. Thank you, our current president. So.
All right. Swiftly moving on. I would say you cannot. There's no way to balance it all. Just do your best. You know, make sure everything's taken care of. Like John said, with the family is important, the work's important. That lets you continue to exist, and then just make the most of the time you get for gaming and sleep.
Yep.
I know we all like to lie in bed a little bit extra sometimes, but maybe if you feel like you got enough sleep, just get the heck up, start doing some stuff. That's how you do it. I've met those guys who are super efficient, manage to get so much stuff done. Sometimes you just gotta get up and do stuff. Give up YouTube. God, Lord knows where most of my free time goes. YouTube.
I prefer not to lion in bed. I prefer to tiger in bed. Boom. See? I'll tell you, these are the jokes, folks. If you're a patron, you're paying for this. So there you go.
Oh, we're all paying for this, John. We had to hear it.
This is a true statement of fact.
Can I get my money back?
Well.
Don't worry, I do.
Yeah, so does he. So does he. So, all right. Just kind of catching up here on where we're doing. We basically have just blocked out all of the major kind of broad plates on this guy with the coal black. Now, what I'm going to do next is I'm going to paint the pony, and I'm going to come back with some browns for the pony.
Sure the pony's male?
Yep, pony's male.
Okay, cool.
Or the female pony's got cancer in an area. So
right, questions. Back to questions.
We have bumps in the pony.
Oh, questions. Quick, save us questions.
Yeah.
Matthew Thomas Antosh asks, is it rude to play LGS and then not buy anything after you're done? Oof, that's a tough one.
So I'm going to answer. I'll answer and then you guys can answer. I think that what's important is that you buy things from your LGS. I think that it's unreasonable for an LGS to expect you to roll in and make a purchase every time you enter the shop. However, I have not purchased a thing from an online distributor since I moved to Games Universe. And the reason I do that, now not everybody can do that, and I understand, but it's a personal commitment I've made to myself. That store has a wonderful meta with wonderful people in it. And if it were not for that game store, I don't know that I'd still be playing the game. And I think that I need to recognize that and support them with my money. So I am a huge fan of making sure that you are supporting your local game store. You shouldn't go in there expecting to spend every week, but you should purchase your miniatures from them. John?
I totally agree, though I do have a rule that if I go to any event at another game store, I try to purchase something. If it's a free event or super cheap, I definitely purchase something because I want that store to continue to do stuff.
Yes.
If it's a slightly more expensive event, like we went to the Mid-Atlantic Team Tournament, it was a slightly more expensive event, so I didn't necessarily purchase anything from the store. I mean, I did end up, but I didn't like go out of my way to.
Yep. Like when I visited your store, John, I purchased stuff when I visited in Maryland.
Mm-hmm. It's a good thing. You can let the store know. People came in, let them see. And this is weird, but it's important. If you're at your local store and you want to purchase stuff, try and do it on the game night.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
That way they go, oh, game night, more money. We should keep doing these game nights.
Very true. Good perspective. Gonzo, your thoughts?
I have also a personal one that if I go to another place and there's a tournament, I always try to buy something. I mean, it could be just some dice, just something. And it doesn't always have to be a lot. Doesn't have to be, you know, anything big. It's just a personal thing because I firmly believe that if we don't keep the stores open, we don't get to play. Not many people have a bedroom or a room or a place where 10, 15 people can, you know, get together and have out and play games.
Yep.
So yeah, don't feel like you have to though. Because I mean, if you feel like you have to, then it's going to be a problem. But I do it because I want to keep playing at these different places.
Yep.
My local, I buy pretty much most of my stuff from my local. The only time I didn't is maybe when there's like something comes out really early. Like, you know, War Machine Weekend or whatever, but it's like one model.
Yeah.
Or if there's something I want two of, like, I don't want to pay, you know, almost $250, $300 for two Colossals, depending on what I pick. So I'll buy one at the store and then get the other one through any other type of means at a cheaper, or, you know, like I did with my PG points. I'm not going to be playing that Colossal all the time, two Colossal lists all the time. So it's not like I feel, you know, bad about doing that.
That's fair.
Yeah. And it's spend what you can at the store. You don't spend it all. If you want to support, if you want to buy it on Amazon or Discount Games or Miniature Market or whatever, because their price is better. I mean, that's on you. Just try and purchase what you can from the store.
Now,
you know,
we're kind of blessed, I think, the three of us, in that the stores that we play in do a really nice job of supporting the players. And I feel for folks that are in a different situation. I know that Rich has in Buffalo has had some issues with his LGS. Just simply not getting in stuff that they ordered. And that's not okay. And so he has no choice but sometimes to go to the online retailers in order to obtain a model that he needs for his armies. And the failing of that retailer, gosh darn it. And they need to realize that they have to have the product, or at least get the product for us if we're willing to pay the money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I agree.
And then if you ever end up in that case, if they ever start turning it around, you got to start buying from them because it has to show up in their pocket. But you can't go, hey, man, I'd buy here, but you never have anything. Then when they start getting stuff, not buying stuff, that's
not good.
That's not going to work because, remember, they're paying money. That's going to sit on their shelf if you're not buying it. It's a symbiotic relationship. We need each other to continue going.
Yep. And another thing, guys, don't, I mean, we can say what we want about the darn magic community, but none of these stores would exist without magic. So while they may have issues, just be, you know, be kind, because turns out we kind of need them a little bit.
Yep, it's easy money that pays the bills.
Yep, so we have a cool place to play. So there you go. That was a good, I think that was a very good question.
Yeah.
Legit.
So let's end up our last question we have that we're going to cover tonight is from Scott Hebel.
Mm-hmm. Love that guy.
What's your favorite MST3K quote?
Oh, my God. So funny thing that he brings this up is that Belinda, librarian, myself, and Charles sat down to watch Manos, The Hands of Fate, which is one of the more famous ones. That show's fucking unwatchable.
I would say infamous more than famous.
Yeah, it's infamous. Yeah, that show is fucking unwatchable. And oh, yeah, that was hilarious. Yeah. I'll tell you a story about that in Adepticon, Gonzo. But So favorite quote. I don't know if I've got like a single favorite quote. I would say one of my favorite running bits on the show was anytime there was a karate scene or something like that, it'd be Haikiba and or Gymkata or something like that they would say. So also, I am a Joel Hodgson guy. I'm sorry, that show kind of turned the corner for me when Mike Nelson became the major host. So I'm hoping I am a Mike hater. I'm hoping that the new one will be good because Joel Hodgson's at the helm again.
Gonzo?
I'm like him. I can't go with it. I mean, I can't go with a quote because everything's... It all depends on the show. It all depends on what they're showing, what they're doing. And some of you're just laughing your ass off, and it's just... Oh. It's good.
What about the song for Gamera? Gamera is really neat. Gamera is full of meat. We're all eating Gamera. That's a good one.
If I do one single quote, it would be, he tried to kill him with a forklift.
Which movie is that one from?
He tried to kill him with a forklift. Fugitive Alien.
Nice.
But really my favorite is actually a two-part, because you need the lead-in from Gypsy, where she started off asking Crow. She's like, Crow, I don't get you. And he goes through this whole diatribe, and like, it ends up with, really, is it Tom Servo you don't get? She goes to Tom Servo, he's like, Tom, I don't get you. And Tom's like, nobody gets me, baby. I'm the wind.
That's so good. So Netflix now has on a best of MST3K that's pretty good. It's like 10 episodes, and it's pretty damn good.
Cool. Amazon actually has a bunch of movies that are the Riff Tracks versions on there, too, in a similar vein.
Yep.
In fact, a Megaforce Riff Tracks version is just as good as the regular Megaforce version. I've watched both somehow.
So, there you go. The pony's coming along. I think what's probably next is to start moving into the golds. So, I think, let's see, we've got 7 minutes. I'll probably put some gold on him.
Get some gold on him.
Gotta get that gold.
Bling. All right. Bling.
Bling, bling.
Bling this guy out. And then we're going to be getting into a movie section. This is going to be pretty good, I think.
It's a heck of a movie section. I watched quite a few movies this week.
Yep. I was on an airplane for a while. So we had no more questions then from the Brushheads or anything like that?
Only the one from Crimson that I am saving.
Okay.
Hey, so why don't we put a shout out to the Brushheads of who's all going to be at Adepticon.
Sure. Let's do that, because we are going to be there. So let's see. I know that Tracy Carter is going to be at Adepticon. What about anybody else? Who all is coming there?
Oh, boy. Let's see. I know someone mentioned he was asking who was going to be there, but that's I've had to refresh for him.
That was Ryan Goes. He was asking who was going to be there. I know that the Minister of Great Times is going to be there, along with Mike Wick and Pete Capozzo, who are legends of the beer machine variety. By the way, funny story, Mike Wick was one of, I actually gave him his first demo of War Machine and Hordes back when I was a press ganger, and he still played the game, which is pretty amazing.
So I know John L. Marshall is going to be there. Try and find him and say hi if you can.
Oh, for sure.
I know for at least part of it, he's going to be playing in the 40K team tournament with his buds that he does every year. Even though he doesn't play much 40K during the year, he still plays in the team tournament.
That's cool.
Yeah, they go in with no expectations of winning, just having a good time. That's the right thought.
Heck yeah, man. That's the way to play games for fun. Yes. I hear they're games. We should probably have fun doing them. Just a thought.
What?
Just a thought.
Madness. This is serious business, dog.
Yo, serious business.
Serious business with two Z's for a double dose of your Z-in.
Business.
Anybody else popping up in the chat room that says they're going to go?
Negative right now. Okay. Dracos Dragoon wishes. Yeah, it'd be good. I know next year we're trying to get a, in addition to us going and wrecking the ATC.
Nice.
We're trying to get everyone together at Adepticon. I should be able to make it. It shouldn't be a problem.
Maybe
I can convince L. Marshall to drive. We'll get there faster from the plane because he drives at the speed of light.
Hey, Cole. It's the speed of thought.
I'll just make sure I wear adult diapers. It'll make it easy.
There you go.
Hang your butt out the window.
That's not okay. That's not okay. KBEC67 says he'll be dropping by on Saturday to say hi, hello to the community, which is cool.
Yep.
You better have a cigar for me too.
Oh shit.
I'll be there with the Chuck on that Saturday for sure, probably on Friday also. So come on in and see Troll Chuck.
I will be working. Owen, I'll be getting off at normal time, so like
Owen the Cooler will be there. He will be Owen is gonna be staying at the Fabulous Casa John on Wednesday night and then be with the rest of his crew after that. So I figured, you know, he's a Canadian. He's a refugee. I'd offer some refugee status here at Casa John.
That's sweet.
Yeah.
So like I say, what's the point of having a place near a big con if you don't give them a chance to stay there a little bit?
That's right. And so Beer Machine Rich will, of course, be with in the Fabulous Casa John suite for the for Adepticon. We'll be driving back and forth. He can get wrecked, yo, and I will be driving.
Get wrecked, nerd.
Yeah.
Comic Scotty Pay says he might have to try and go next year if we're trying to make an appearance.
Yep, we're going to be we're going to be at the ATC next year too, representing Team Painting with Menoth John.
Representing as to the best of our abilities.
Yep, we're going to win that motherfucker. Look out.
Rolling
Jake.
Dice.
Look out, Jake.
On that on that note, remember I told you one of the best players in my meta went and didn't win a single game?
Right.
He was at the tournament. I chatted with him about it. He said that a lot of it was, you know, once he timed out, he was in a great position, just took too much time. And another one, a couple others, he basically left them with no choice but like 25 or 30 percenters, and they took them and got them.
Okay.
So that'll probably make me feel a little better. I mean, it's...
No, we're going to dominate.
There's dice involved.
We're going to dominate. I mean, it's not even going to be... First thing we do, guys, our first strategy is that we ask every round to each of our opponents, would you like to concede now? We deploy the models, and we give them the opportunity. That might work once or twice, okay? That's our key. If we can get that to work once or twice, I think we've got a legit chance.
I've got a better way.
What's that?
We get everybody freaking drunk the night before.
Yep.
On, like, cough syrup and, you know, Jägermeister.
Nice. Ooh. Like it. I like where this is headed.
And then we come in wearing, you know, taps on our shoes, you know, like the drill instructors, mm-hmm. and bells on our hips. So everywhere we walk, all that great noise.
And we offer everybody a greasy ham sandwich served in an ashtray.
Yes.
Boom. Boom. I think we got this, guys. This is the kind of strategy shit that, you know, this is next level coaching we're talking about right here. They don't even know. Bitches don't know about how good we are at coaching. So... All right, guys.
Oh.
We don't want to give away all of our secrets, or else everybody's going to be surfing greasy ham sandwiches served in an ashtray. And that doesn't work. You can't have that. Everybody will be using our tech.
That's right.
Painting with Menoth John. That's where you get your tech from. All right, man.
The most advanced tech.
I'm switching this over to the media section.
It's about that time.
We have a lot to talk about, folks. This is some serious business. So, just for those of you who are actually caring about what I was painting, I'm sorry. Let's get that out of the way. I took the swoop cam out. So I got all of the coal black blockout done, and I got the horse flesh done. Now I'm working on my way through the golds, and there's going to be a lot of gold on this dude because you got to get that gold. And so I'll start working on that tomorrow and during the rest of the week and see how far I can get before Adepticon. But I don't think Feora 3 is going to probably end up getting Adepticon. So where do we want to start this week, John? Do we want to start off with the moment everyone's been working, waiting for, and literally the reason we have 26 people watching right now?
Let's hit it. Let's give them what they're waiting for.
So, folks, you know, we have a rating scale on this show. In case you haven't, we haven't gone over the rating scale in a long time, have we, John?
No, we haven't. But I mean, I think Shots of Kraken's pretty self-explanatory.
It could be. It could be. And but I'll explain it anyway because that uses time, and that's what we're all about. So we have a it's the Shots of Kraken scale is how many shots it takes you to get drunk enough to enjoy the show. Now, for years, John,
enjoy.
Well, in air quotes, to be able to not stomach it either, because you're probably going to throw up.
To watch the whole thing.
To watch the whole
completion.
Thing. In a single set down. Okay.
Oh.
And that's fucking important for the show we're about to talk about. It's the key is watching it in a single set down. You know, folks. I'm pretty convinced that you could probably, like, someone could shoot you with a gun, and if, you know, and then like, you get patched up, and you come back, and then somebody shoots you again, and you could repeat that sequence, like, 8 times in a row, if there was, like, a year in between each one, okay? But if you get shot 8 times in a row, or in this case, 5 times in a row, you're probably dead, okay? So...
Which 50 Cent.
So, exactly. So, Shots of Kraken is our scale, and for a long time we've had the pinnacle of just horseshit movies being the 5 Shots of Kraken, and that was, of course, Turkish Star Wars. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with what Turkish Star Wars is, first, I'm ashamed of you. Secondly, there's no need to be in the dark on Turkish Star Wars. You can go to YouTube and watch it. And
Turkish Star Wars is the epitome of the 5 Shots of Kraken, and you enjoy the movie at that point.
Right. And it's, or you go and take part in an RPG. One of those two. So,
that's still a little sore there, sir.
It's a smile when you say that, sir.
Hats off to the guy from Combo Spite who hung in there with me for you.
Yep. Good job. We have a contender. A contender has arisen, literally from out of the water. So we've talked about this particular movie on the show before, and John has told us about it. And I was in Seattle and had too much time on my hands. Folks, we have a new God King Emperor of the 5 Shots of Kraken scale. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to talk about Atlantic Rim.
Oh, you didn't believe me.
I didn't believe you.
Nobody believes me.
I didn't believe you. I didn't think it would be possible. So let's paint the landscape. Turkish Star Wars features guys in bad furry outfits and completely stolen footage from Star Wars running in backwards and guys dressed up in terrible, like, Air Force helmets that they found in a junkyard. It has more production value than Atlantic Rim. The acting is far better in Turkish Star Wars than it is.
There is acting in Turkish Star Wars.
There is.
No acting in Atlantic Rim.
There isn't. The acting as a craft died in this movie. So you've got 3 main characters, if you can call them that. One is the prototypical bro with spiked up hair. Then you have,
but he's the best we've got.
He's the best we've got. Then we have the female pilot who's blonde, who wears makeup in combat. Full makeup in combat. And then we have an African-American gentleman.
Who is the best character in the fucking movie?
Who has decides when he's rescuing the little girl from the from the burning house that his superhero name is Superfly. Oh my god, it was too perfect. I'm Superfly. Come on out, let's see my Superfly mobile. You
Gonzo,
can't
don't ever watch the movie,
make
trust me.
Oh, no, no, no. I'm going to because I love crap like this because I can sit there and go, stuff.
No. No, you can't, Gonzo.
That's the problem. It's not a movie that you can love for anything in it. It's terrible. Like Sharknado, you can love. This movie is just horrible.
It's so
bad. I watched the trailer because when you made a post on Facebook about it, I was like, okay, let me see what he's talking about. And I watched the trailer and I sat there and I was like, there is hell and it's in this movie.
You're right.
It's
goddamn right.
If hell has a movie theater, all it shows is Atlantic Rim. And by the way, yes, that is Rain of Fire in the background. We have a very talented graphic artist that does our stuff for us. Gary does amazing work. And if you need any graphic design work done, ping me on PwMenothJohn, and I will send you his email to get in touch with him because he's amazing. So I guess, John, we probably ought to talk through the plot because I guess there's one.
Not really.
So a monster attacks, and it's the monster's actually the best special effect in the whole show, I think.
That's horrible.
So bad.
Oh, God. Yeah.
And,
it's bad. And
these three pilots whose robots have been creatively named Blue, Red, and Green.
Guess what colors they are?
They're blue, red, and green.
Boom.
And the pilots wear blue, red, and green body wetsuits. And they drop them from overhead cranes. For like land-based overhead cranes, and they drop for hundreds of fathoms. There's no port in the universe that drops 700 fathoms off of its dock. That's just not how worlds are created.
Look, this movie and reality have nothing in common.
No,
nothing.
They don't even talk anymore. It's not about seeing other people. They've never heard of each other anymore.
How about the set, quotations, for the cockpit of the aircraft?
That.
Somebody's tractor, for fuck's sake! God damn, this! I haven't even watched it in forever, and it still pisses me off.
It's so bad. And they can, you know, you remember in Pacific Rim, they had the suite, you know, they had to be two of them in the suit, and they were moving in unison, and it was hokey, but it looked cool and all that kind of stuff. These guys have two handles to use that they've ripped out of a surplus airplane, a helicopter surplus store, and they're like jerking them back and forth, kind of, but not a lot. They're not jerking around a lot. And then for some reason, anytime they actually use the robots, they're getting very hot inside. I'm burning up. I'm burning up. It's so hot in here.
Well, I was so hoping the whole movie would catch fire.
Oh, God. So, who's the guy, the Admiral? Because he's been in a lot of things.
He's needed a paycheck. That's who he...
I feel so bad for him.
The last thing I remember him in seeing and cognitively remembering him from is he was in Die Hard with a Vengeance.
Yes.
And he did a decent job in that movie. You're like, he was exactly what he needed to be.
He's not a bad actor. He's an okay actor with the script that would not live thrown at him. And I'm pretty sure
Graham
he's...
Graham Greene?
Okay.
Yes.
I am pretty sure that his script was act like an asshat was the only lines that were in the script.
But He was the second best character in the movie.
Yes.
Yes. The black guy, him, and then fuck everyone else. Then
fuck all the rest of the movie. His second in command with the eye patch, with the scar that doesn't go all the way to his eye because the patch shifted.
This movie.
Turkish stuff. Turkish.
I feel like there are high schools out there whose drama department has made better productions than this.
Oh my God, yes. And then the awkward scene in the bar where the black guy and the blonde admit to having hooked up, and that meant kissing. The big reveal to they tell the red pilot that they hooked up and that it was kissing, and then this was supposed to be some kind of big emotional scene. It lasted 20 seconds and he immediately got over it. Now, if you're that woman and your boyfriend is that nonchalant about you getting drunk with one of your fellow pilots and who knows where that led.
That's just a regular office party. I mean, sorry.
Yeah. So, no, Turkish Star Wars is not for the faint of heart. This is for someone who doesn't have a heart. This is for someone who has given up on life. This is the definitive five shots of Kraken, point or counterpoint.
Point. It's, I can't argue with you. I've been saying that for a while. It's my new barometer for worst movie. I will gladly watch Batman versus Superman any edition rather than having to watch this shit. I don't care if it's almost twice as long.
Oh my God, yes.
It'll still hurt less.
Yes. So Gonzo, you have choices to make in life at this point.
Don't watch it.
You can follow us down this rabbit hole and then and be able to be qualified to judge movies moving forward. or you can puss out and not watch it. So where are you going to go?
Oh, I'm going to watch it. I'm actually going to have probably a party. And I'm going to line up shots along the back of my couch.
Man.
And have people with me and do it all together. And lock the doors so nobody can get out and leave.
Don't have friends with you because they won't be friends after you make them watch this.
Every time that the red pilot goes, woo, you got to drink a shot.
Oh, okay.
And it's not going to be turn out well for you. So the Clockwork Jester, you know, because we're all about the calculations and the sciences on this show, has pointed out that 700 fathoms, which I believe is the depth that they went to, is 3/4 of a mile. The average depth of the ocean is between 2.5 and 3 miles deep. So ports are about 40 or 50 feet. So where I'm from, that port is fucking deep. So...
That port's deeper than anything else in the movie.
Without question. Well played, sir. Well played. I think we spent enough time on this. We have now recalibrated the Kraken scale. John, you watched something better this week. Please tell me.
Oh, I watched 4 movies. All were better.
Okay.
But the 2 I most want to talk about is a little movie from the 80s called Tron.
Tron,
and I followed
yeah.
it up a day later with Tron Legacy. Mm. It's a sequel.
I like them both.
Yeah, absolutely. Unfortunately, this news comes with the recent news that they're not making another sequel. They're going to reboot it.
Oh.
I don't know why, but anyways, Tron may be hard for you youngins to watch because
yeah.
it comes from back in a time where computers were huge, and I mean huge.
Yep.
And computers couldn't do what they do today. Like, if you show someone from back then what we're doing now with a computer, they'd be like, "That is science fiction. That can't happen." And it's got a very simple plot. It's a simple, non-violent vengeance plot. Software engineer stole other software engineer's stuff, got promoted up to, you know, executive vice president of the company. Other software engineer just wants to get in the system, find the information, and prove that he stole his stuff. It's simple. In the process, though, the one software engineer, Jeff Bridges, mm-hmm. Kevin Flynn, gets sent into the computer. They set up everything fairly well in this. It's pretty well done. And he has to go play games. And really, this was sort of like a showpiece movie. Look what we can do with computers mm-hmm. and graphics for movies nowadays. And, I mean, nowadays, it doesn't hold up, but for the time, it was amazing.
Yeah.
And it's really simple plot of them going on an adventure. He gets with some computer programs and escapes from the bad guys and goes and gets information to, you know, prove that the bad guy stole his stuff. It's, like I said, very simple plot. There's not necessarily a lot of character development in it, but it is a hell of a good ride.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
And if you think about the time it came out, watch other movies at the time and look at it, you will see just how good these graphics are.
Yep.
Though I do suggest getting the, like, if you're going to watch this, find the best quality copy you can. Blu-ray is a must. It's still going to look grainy, but that's just because it's old and it's supposed to be when they're in the computer.
Yeah.
Super good. Has a good soundtrack. Though it doesn't hold up to its sequel soundtrack by any stretch, but
no.
No. And it's got a lot of cool stuff. Light cycle scenes, awesome. It's got Bruce Boxleitner in addition to Jeff Bridges. Those are pretty much the only big actors in there. And it's a good, fun ride. I would say nowadays, people probably give it 2 shots of Kraken because it doesn't hold up very well. I give it 0 because it brings you back to my childhood, and man, I love the heck out of that movie.
Yeah, I would put this also on probably 0 to 1, maybe a half. But if you're going to have a half a shot, have one. And only just because it's so much fun. It is a bit of a period piece. It represents a period in video games that we're probably never ever going to see again, where
society, even because it's arcades were big, you know, the computers were small. God, the internet was barely a thing at that point.
Yep. And so I really recommend Tron. Gonzo, your thoughts?
Oh, 100%. It's a classic. That's one of my you must see shows and movies, because, like I said, you look at it now and you're like, damn, those graphics suck.
Yeah.
But you're like, now think about when that was done. And you're like, okay, I could see how this was cool.
Yeah, was it 83-ish? Something like that? Maybe even earlier? I mean, you think that's 30 years ago?
Yeah.
More?
That was strong medicine for its day. So now let's move on to the more modern sequel that came out
Tron
4 years ago.
More than that.
Okay, more than that.
Yeah, I mean, I think Tron Legacy is like 2011-ish.
Okay.
Let us find out, shall we?
God, it doesn't feel that.
2010.
God,
7 years old now.
Gonzo, this is what happens when you're old. The years move by so fast. I'm asking you.
I have no clue what you're talking about.
Well, the years move by so fast because you have frame of reference of so many more years, so each additional year seems less long because
thank you
of how much has come before it.
Thank you for that, Save. That's why you're the co-host, buddy.
But Tron,
I'm surprised he can hear us most of the time.
What? What?
Tron Legacy has only one glaring flaw. Is it tries too hard to both be a remake but not entirely be a remake of Tron.
Yeah.
It has functionally a better story.
Mm-hmm.
About the same amount of character, a little bit more character development. Flynn's son does, Jeff Bridges' son does have a little bit of character development. It does get the entire cast. Everyone who they could get back gets back.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everyone in it who's playing a role from earlier is back.
Yep.
And the graphics are stunning.
Yeah, it's
absolutely stunning.
It's a tour de force.
The light cycle scene in comparison to the original is just like, you get that weak shit out of here. I don't care how good it was back then. Look at this shit.
Yeah.
And it's a good movie. It just, it's hard to get out of the shadow of a classic.
Yeah.
And people coming in new probably didn't have enough background to watch it. And people coming in from the old one would be like, this is too much like the original. And that's really the only place it goes wrong, in my opinion.
It finds a tough middle ground that it has to, mm-hmm. It went to exactly probably the wrong place, but it's still a darn fun movie. And it's a feast for the eyes and ears.
Absolutely. Daft Punk does the soundtrack, and you heard that, you're like, oh, come on, they can't do a soundtrack. And then you hear the soundtrack, you're like, fuck yeah, they can do a soundtrack.
They can actually do a soundtrack.
They yeah, I mean, it says a lot. They took that shit to 11.
Oh, they sure did. And yeah. I don't own many, many soundtracks, and I own the soundtrack to Tron Legacy.
Yeah, Tron Legacy was a must-have soundtrack. Daft Punk, I mean, the best work they've ever done. It's amazing.
Yep.
The movie is also quite good. It's worth owning. Another good one for a Blu-ray copy because it's such a great picture.
Yep.
A good enough story. And I find it's a better watch if you watch Tron than maybe a couple nights later you watch Tron Legacy. You get the whole thing together. And then a must-see at the end is a special feature called Flynn Lives.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just like a 15-minute short film they made afterwards, which explains some of the other stuff going on.
Okay, cool.
It's very good. I give it about one shot of Kraken just because it does miss the mark. But man, it's just so good, audio and visual. You just gotta like it, and yeah. It's fun.
Yeah.
And to anyone out there who ever decides to make a movie, if you make your movie fun, people will watch it.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter if you miss the mark, as long as it's fun.
Yep, absolutely. I'm with you, John. I'm going to give it one shot of Kraken just because it does miss that one mark. It ends in that uncanny valley between trying to be something new and being something old. But I own it in Blu-ray. I love it. I've watched it several times. I nothing but good marks. Gonzo?
I agree with y'all. I mean, coming back from the original one to the new one, it was a great movie. Good, even if you didn't even know Tron, the first one, you could still watch this one and be okay. But it does try to, like, oh, we're trying to grab that fan base of Tron 1. So, yeah, mm-hmm. I go one shot. Otherwise, yeah, cool. It's a great movie. Good fun.
Can I talk about the next movie?
Go ahead.
So, one of the things that's cool about flying on airplanes is that sometimes you get to watch movies that aren't available in the United States. And one of those movies that's not available, at least that I can't find it, maybe John, you can find it, is Shin Godzilla, which is the movie that is from Toho, yeah, which is the original Godzilla movie house. And it is the most recent Godzilla movie. And I think it's the best Godzilla movie I have ever watched. It is, it takes the origins, it's an origin story Godzilla movie. It is a full reboot of the Godzilla story from the point where he emerges from the sea and begins to evolve into the Godzilla we know and love. So Godzilla's shtick this time is that he can actually evolve, and he evolves on a fast timetable. And it's the story. What ends up happening is this is a political commentary on the state of affairs in Japan right now. It's actually, it talks about, it's more about the government's inability and inflexibility to react to an emergency situation. And the bad things that result from how beholden they are to the United States. And it's all this movie could have been 25 minutes long had the inflexibility in the Japanese government allowed them to attack Godzilla before he turned into his eventual state that he turned into. But because they couldn't, they were too inflexible of a government. They couldn't react properly at that time. And as a result, all shit broke loose. And that is the kind of the theme of the movie, is that Japan needs to be more nimble. They need to be less bureaucratic. And they need to be less, they need to be their own country. That they've paid back the sins of World War II. And now they need to be more independent of the United States. That's what this movie is really about. And it just happens to have a big giant lizard in it that shoots laser beams and fireballs out of its mouth. It's as good of a giant monster movie as I've ever seen. So, John, I know you're doing a little bit of research. Have you found anywhere that you can actually watch Shin Godzilla in the United States?
Not yet, but I'm sure they're out there. It's just, exceeding my
your Google foo?
Gofu right this moment.
Yep. I'm going to say that this is worth going to Delta and buying a ticket. So, so fly to Seattle. Chances are better than not, you're going to have a long flight and watch Shin Godzilla. It is fantastic. And there is a little thing that happens at the end. No spoilers. Makes me think they're going to do another one. So we'll see. Gonzo, we've talked a lot. Do you have any movies you wanted to talk about?
Since we're doing kind of flashbacks and, you know, retroing movies, I actually watched Blade Trinity again. And I actually like that movie, even though with all the dorkiness and everything going on, and it's because of Ryan Reynolds.
Because
I remember when I first saw that movie and the scenes in it where he's cracking jokes while getting his ass beat, I go, you know, he'd make a really good Deadpool if he could come up with this and keep these jokes going. And now that it's come true, I'm like, shit. So I had to rewatch it because of that. And I was like, I was enjoying it the whole way through. I mean, it's not the greatest, but it's just a good action start of all the superhero movies too. But I enjoyed that movie and a lot of nostalgia out of that.
Outstanding. How many shots of Kraken?
Pushing it to two maybe, but other than that, it was really good.
Yeah, that'll happen. That'll happen. Well, any other movies you wanted to talk about, John?
I want to give a quick one out to, I watched Remo Williams' The Adventure Begins on Friday when I got home. And that's a perfect example of a movie that's really shitty, but man, it's enjoyable and watchable, and I love the hell out of it.
Oh, doesn't that have Treat Williams in it?
No.
I thought that hit.
Fred
Ward, okay.
And Joel Grey is a Korean guy. I'm not sure that's okay anymore, but those movies, it doesn't do anything hatefully, so you're like, I'll let you go. Shikas Chun is slightly racist and slightly sexist. Slightly, I mean a lot.
Such a great movie.
It's super fun. It's such another one of the product of its times when they walk past this giant room of computers and he's like, I thought they made this thing smaller. And the other guy's like, those are the small ones. Oh, man. I feel like that movie is ripe for a remake. It's based off the Destroyer series of books, which I've read a couple of. I feel like you could make a good remake of it nowadays. I don't think you need to make it R. I think you could probably still go PG because it's mostly kung fu action. And I'd love to see that with some, you know, maybe up-and-coming quasi-martial arts guys so you can make the combat scenes a little bit better. But, man, Fred Ward had... He was the right man for this movie. He's got just enough charisma and charm to pull it off.
Cool.
So, very cool. I give it one shot of Kraken. Anyone else is probably going to give it 2.5 or more because it doesn't hold up all the time. I just love it.
I have not watched it. I'll have to put it on the list of things to watch at some point.
Oh,
greatest. Oh yeah, John, you got to see this movie. Yes.
John, you're amazing.
No, I am better than that.
If we're just kind of kicking around a couple quick things, The Expanse continues to be fucking mind blowing. So
you're taunting me again.
Just go buy it. And
I can't. I got to buy Incredible Hulk for my co-host corner.
Okay.
That's right. On the Co-host Corner, I'm doing what I call, because I'm witty, the Avengers Initiative, where I'm going through all the Marvel movies in order, and I'm going to review them all.
Okay, so Gonzo, do you own season 2, or are you watching it?
Oh, yeah, I'm watching it. I'm up to current
episode. All right, episode. And you've watched season 1, right, John?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, all season 1, absolutely.
All right, I'm tossing you the 20 for the second season. So all
right,
the Empire will pay for this one, so we need to bring you up to date.
I will make the time.
Yes, the first
GT. I don't think it's that bad. No, not the first one. The second one.
The second one's fine. The first one
Edward
is
Edward Norton.
The Ed Norton. Yeah,
Edward Norton.
Yeah.
That first one doesn't exist in the Marvel continuity, so I don't have to watch it.
Yeah.
Just like Daredevil. Though to be fair, I actually don't hate Daredevil. The movie.
And that's how the podcast ended.
It's not that bad. Jesus, I mean, we talked about Atlantic Rim for fuck's sake. It ain't even in the same league as Atlantic Rim.
The first one is not 5 shots. Let's get that straight. It is not five shots. It is not Atlantic Rim. It is it is a terrible fever dream of a movie, but it is not Atlantic Rim. Atlantic Rim is like getting your fucking ass reamed out with hot pokers and bad things. So it's terrible. It's terrible. So there you go, folks. You know what? We've entertained you for 90 minutes, and we did a pre-ramble, so that was more than that. You know, folks, at this time of the show, I like to stop and get emotional a little bit. No, I don't. Anyway, so this is the Painting with Menoff John Sunday Night Extravaganza. You know, folks, we enjoy being here every Sunday with you, and the next time we're with you, we're going to be with you for a long fucking time. So, give us your thoughts. What are some things we should talk about on the show? Big, meaty topics that take hours to talk about. That's what we're looking for. On behalf of the co-host with the most, the mighty right hand of the podcast, Mr. John Spencer, and of course, the scruffy guy, Irrational Gonzo, I am your comely host, Mr. Menoff John, and I will see you at Adepticon, and if you say, hey, Ron, I'll high-five you or some shit. All right, so there you go. We'll be at Adepticon. I'll be with my kids. So if you use four-letter words, try to use them in a full, complete sentence with subject, verb, and direct object. All right, so there you go. We'll see you next time. This has been Painting with Menoff John. We'll see you next time. Good night, everybody. Fucking Atlantic Rim.
I saw your post on Facebook.
I may never be the same.
And I instantly went to the trailer and I went, fuck, I've got to watch this.
My super...
No. So bad.
No, don't do it.
My superhero name is Superfly.